Hello everyone. Today we have the privilege and the pleasure of interviewing Dr. Lungi Nyathi, a prominent figure in African business and leadership, currently the CEO of Aligned, a company that focuses on, and I'm going to say this slowly because it's a long introduction, patient-centered, cost-effective healthcare through their aligned incentives and holistic solutions. Welcome, Dr. Lungi.
Thank you.
I think I'm excited to have this conversation. I think our viewers are also going to benefit a lot from this conversation. But let's kick into it. I think let's get into it. You have an absolutely impressive background in health economics and in medicine in general. How do you see the convergence of healthcare and technology shaping the future of healthcare delivery in Africa?
Well, what we know for sure is that the cost of healthcare must reduce. We know for sure that patients need more value. They need coordinated care. They need to be empowered to make decisions. They need efficient service. We know that doctors need to be able to provide service in a much simpler way. We know that there are not enough healthcare professionals in South Africa and globally. And so we need more innovative ways of providing healthcare, and without a shadow of a doubt, that's going to mean that we need health technology to assist with all of these problems. We know that women are going to be key in this conversation. We know that young people are going to make up more and more of the health of the African landscape and population. So we cannot actually avoid health tech. It's going to become important, and as we invest in it and we think about how to provide healthcare, we're going to have to use technology.
In your role as CEO of Aligned, how do you foster an inclusive work environment that supports the growth and development of women in leadership positions?
Well, as Aligned, from the beginning, we were founded by females. It was very female-led. We knew we had to intentionally invest in letting the feminine show up in business. Mm-hmm. We're in a male-dominated industry, as sure. Business all is. And care, up till now, has been led mainly by men. Some of the elements of femininity, care, intuition, collaboration, all of those elements needed to be brought into this landscape. And so we've intentionally hired quite a few women, very, very strong in female leadership, female employment. And then we have to intentionally think about how do we build the culture of the organism so that it is inclusive and equitable. Everything from how we run our meetings to the contracts we sign to the policies like the paternity policy, parental policy. Did I say paternity?
You said paternity, so you included the
parental
men.
Policy. Mm. We did include them.
Okay.
We did include them in the parental policy, but we've had to be intentional about
sure.
it. It's not something that happens easily. But if you're wanting to empower and to build inclusivity, one has to be intentional about it.
You're calling it an organism and not an organization.
That's what
Why?
We are. Because we're a living thing.
Nice.
It is a living thing. We don't build structures that are solid and rigid. We're influenced by the people in the organism. We're influenced by the external factor, and we constantly have to change and live and breathe.
So you're an amoeba.
We're very, very living.
Okay, cool. So Aligned's mission sort of focuses on patient-centered and cost-effective healthcare, mm-hmm. right? And through a lot of collaborative incentives. How do you believe that this approach benefits the healthcare system, and especially women in Africa?
Mm-hmm. Well, I'll start by saying that the way we have intentionally built is to give voice to patients.
Sure.
Most of the system has not empowered patients. They've taken the agency out of patients. Mm-hmm. The majority of people who seek healthcare are women. And so you can imagine, firstly, they're just generally disenfranchised
sure.
in society. Now to come into the healthcare space and not have a voice about what it is that they're looking for, what outcomes they want, that was something we felt strongly about. And so in the way we've designed every product that we've been looking at, we've made sure to ask patients, what is it that you want? What will sure. value look like for you? And then we build to ensure that they get that value. And so that's what patient-centered means for us, is that we think about that and we give voice to it. And then the other thing is we have considered lately women's health in general, and how do we enable women's health solutions that again take into consideration a woman's journey, and also think about the woman's journey throughout their journey and not just when they're making babies. Yeah,
100%.
And so we're spending a lot of time thinking about women and ensuring that their voices are heard and that care is delivered for them. And then the last thing I'll probably say is that the way women access care has had to be intentionally taking into account the way they live, right?
Okay.
Most women can't go into a healthcare facility. We've intentionally brought care into the home to make it easier.
Nice.
For patients, many of which are women, as I've said, to be able to get the care they need at their place. So,
and I think there are a lot of sort of great incentives by the collaboration that you guys are doing at Aligned, because coming from Allegra, obviously we have VirtualCare, which is our telemedicine solution, and what we are seeing in the statistics is that a lot of the sort of requests or patient-doctor visits with the telemedicine solution are very, like, for females, a lot of them, the statistics show that. Repeat scripts for contraception and the likes, UTIs, we get a lot of those type of sort of women-focused issues that are there. And I think with those type of collaborations, healthcare doesn't become so siloed.
Yeah.
You are able to then bring in a lot of different sort of businesses or organisms, like you would call them, to come together to create something really beneficial for women in general.
Yeah. I mean, we strongly believe that we can't solve all the problems by ourselves.
Sure.
We've got a specific mission, a specific vision, and partnering with like-minded individuals and organizations is something we feel strongly about. It is important to solve the kind of problems that we need to solve to work with everybody else, so that the solutions we all put in place have considered all the other players. A lot of money is wasted, frankly, in the fact that we don't actually speak to each other. A lot of care is uncoordinated, again, because we don't think about the whole thing end to end. So collaboration and partnerships are big for us.
Very big. That's awesome. So let's talk about something more sentimental, more emotional. Mm. I think throughout your career journey, what have been some of the most rewarding moments for you, especially as a leader advocating for positive change in the healthcare industry as a whole?
You know, one of the things I live by now is that some of the problems that we have, we're not going to solve by fixing what exists. We're going to have to create new things. And so it has been so rewarding in looking after Alliance palliative care patients to have 1,000 families who ordinarily would not have had the dignity, the pleasure of having their loved ones die at home with them around them. Most of them would have died in hospital, in high cares and ICUs, but to be able to be dignified and live all the way to the end has been phenomenal. That's top of mind, I suppose, because I live it every day. I've loved mentoring young people in my journey. Corporate enables you to be able to do that. So it's been great to see some of the young people that we've brought into the organization to grow them, to mentor them, and see them become leaders of their own now. That's been wonderful. It was great to be part of solutioning for COVID vaccination at the time that it was there. that was something that was unprecedented. We'd never seen pandemics before. We'd never figured out ways to work well, business, private sector, public sector, just all of us coming around. Mm-hmm. It was so great. I really found that rewarding. And then right at the beginning, I loved working at Khayelitsha Day Hospital, just a township hospital that sought to really look after its people and to come up with ways to should make sure that our old women don't come into clinic at four.
Sure.
And put in place systems that there was and put in place systems that enabled that. It was great for me.
I think it goes back to touching on how many of our systems are broken, and I think that's something that you're very passionate about in terms of systems and sorting them out and fixing them or belonging to systems. And do you want to talk more about that?
Yeah, I mean, I think if anyone is going to make a difference in the world, in anything, understanding systems. The world is made up of systems. It's made the healthcare is made up of systems. Politics, families, they're all systems. And I think anyone that wants to play a role needs to study the system, understand all the interlinks, and then figure out your place and play in it.
Sure. I think now touching on that, mm-hmm. as a leader in the health tech industry specifically, mm-hmm. right? What do you see as the most significant opportunities as well as challenges for African women mm-hmm. Sort of aspiring to make a mark in this dynamic field? Mm-hmm. And I think it's a touch point from what you just spoke about.
Mm-hmm. It is indeed. I mean, health tech is something that's being invested in. There's a lot of investment being pumped into health tech. A lot mm-hmm. of people are seeing the opportunities that are there in the health space and in technology specifically.
Sure.
Africa is a growing continent. A lot of the people who are being born, frankly, right now in the world are in Africa, and our cities are gonna be the biggest cities in a few decades. So if you're a woman, being in health and being in tech and being in Africa, you're in the greatest place to be. The difficulty though is that most of the environments are male dominated still.
Sure.
And the way forward, I think, is for women to work together.
Mm-hmm.
The way that we will win as women in this space where there is opportunities to work together, because by and large, nobody's gonna hand you anything, generally speaking.
True.
Most males have been mentored for a long period of time. We're gonna need to mentor each other. We're gonna need to be open to being mentored by people who don't look like us, don't think like us, take the best of what they give, and then create something out of it. But the big thing is all females who are around right now must work together. It's the only way.
And I think also just to touch on that, we're seeing, I mean, with what you were touching on in terms of health tech booming in Africa in general, we're seeing a lot of venture capitalists sort of funding these businesses that are coming up mm-hmm. that are specifically focusing on health tech. But I think the important message is for them to start focusing on health tech businesses actually run by women.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Because we're known to do well in spaces where we are given an opportunity as women to run those businesses,
yeah.
to lead those conversations and to create sort of long-standing relationships
yeah.
and businesses that stand the test of time. I think there's it speaks a lot to that as well.
I fully agree with that. And I think the way the world has run business
mm-hmm.
At the moment has been shown to have key gaps. Most of those gaps will be enabled by women because of the nature of who we are. And so I do think that investing in women-led organizations is going to yield a lot of result for anyone who is courageous and has enough foresight.
So we're ready for a female president in Africa.
Oh, we've been.
Okay, cool. So let's sort of conclude this conversation by asking, you know, I think what message would you like to leave our audience, especially those who are passionate about advancing healthcare in Africa and empowering women in health tech? What's that one message you'd like to leave them? You've been throwing gems this entire interview, and I think there's so many pockets of like important conversations that can come out of this that we could expand on, you know. But I think, what's that one message that you'd like to leave our audience with?
I guess we've spoken about systems, which I care about, sure. So I don't have to go there again, but it is an important one.
Okay.
The other one that I would say, which I guess I've also touched on, is partner.
Sure.
Learn how to partner, learn how to build valuable partnerships, learn how to collaborate. There's a lot of work, internal work, that a person has to do to be able to partner well, because get defensive over time. You know, most of us have had to sustain all kinds of trauma in our lives, wow, of different kinds. And we have to unlearn a lot of those things, mm-hmm, to be able to partner well. But learning how to partner will move you forward.
I think a lot of learning is unlearning things that you have learned that might not work,
yeah,
in what you're going through.
Yeah.
But I think it's important for partnerships, and it's going to be insightful to see how you sort of lead that journey, because I know you will do a lot of that. And it's phenomenal that you are open to having these conversations and having conversations that can actually empower women. And I hope this conversation does reach a lot of women, and we work hard to make sure that it does, because there are a lot of important gems that we get out of this. Another off-the-cuff question that I want to generally ask is, if you had a superpower, what would it be?
I have many already.
I love that. I absolutely love that.
But the ability to work multidimensionally would be great for me. To be able to touch one place and have reverberations in many other spaces, I'd love that superpower.
You don't like wasting time at all?
No time to waste, guys. No time to waste. This generation needs us.
This is now. Hey, the time is now. And I think the time is now for Africa as well, especially where things are going with HealthTech. Here's another one. So what music do you listen to?
I listen to a lot of jazz, I listen to Afrofusion, I like dancing.
So you're on TikTok?
No.
I was about to drop a handle on TikTok.
You can teach me TikTok, you can take me to TikTok and I can learn it, but I'm not on TikTok. I do like dancing.
Are your kids on TikTok?
Of course.
Okay, so is that why you're afraid of going on to TikTok?
No.
Okay.
But I'm willing to be taken there gently and
be guided
to that crazy black hole of TikTok.
No, amazing. I think, thank you so much, Dr. Lungi, for sharing your insights, you know, for sharing your time, for welcoming us into your beautiful home. By the way, she's welcomed us into her stunning home. She's been an amazing host. I've had a couple of cup of teas before we had the session. Maybe we should call it having a cup of tea with Dr. Lungi, I think.
I like that.
I think I like it too. But thank you, everybody, for joining us. And continue joining us in this series that we're going to be having around unlocking healthcare's potential by empowering women with virtual care. And remember to subscribe to our channel. All the details will be right here at the bottom. I've been waiting to say that for a while, by the way. And thank you so much for your time, and keep following us. And women, let's keep making a change. Thank you so much.